Good morning, one and all. Thanks for your time and attending this session. Wishing you all a very happy festive season. The topic of today's webinar is Building Resilient and Agile Supply Chain. Coming to my intro, I am a supply chain professional having 16 years of experience, both in manufacturing and in EPC sectors. Currently, I am associated with Air Products as a senior strategic sourcing specialist. My previous employers are L&T, Vedanta, and Bechtel. Now let's move on to the topic. Every one of us will agree that COVID-19 has affected us and our industries in one way or other. So today we will focus on what COVID-19 has taught us. In fact, what have we learned from this COVID-19 pandemic and what are the repercussions? Now, why resilient and supply chains, resilient and agile supply chains are required, and how to build those supply chains to make us proof, you know, risk proof in future. Coming to the point, what COVID-19 pandemic has taught us? COVID-19 pandemic has taught us VUCA is inevitable and it is intrinsic in today's business environment. Okay, what VUCA is? VUCA is an acronym coined by the American military, initially coined by the American military. VUCA stands for volatility. It is a means it is a liability to change rapidly and unpredictably. I would like to quote an example for one volatility. During COVID-19, the LNG prices and the oil prices have touched the rock bottom price level. So this is one of the best example for the volatility. Because of the change in oil prices, many projects got canceled and it shattered the entire business. So this is the best example of a volatile market. U stands for uncertainty. It means we are not sure what will happen in the future. The one more best example I would like to quote for uncertainty is the political sanctions that many countries impose on some other countries. You know, and now the Western countries, they are imposing the political sanctions on China and some other countries like Turkey, all those stuff. So we don't know what will happen next. And complexity. Complexity, as we all know, complex means it is very complex, very difficult to understand and handle. Now, because of this globalization, many organizations are venturing into new market and in new countries. They are dealing with all the supply chain. It deals with so many countries and with so many contract conditions. So the complexity is whatever the transaction we are doing with the multiple countries will have different cultures, will have different tax structures, will have different duties, etc. We don't know. So it is very difficult and it is very complex in nature to handle all those things. And the last one is ambiguity. Ambiguity is inexactness. We don't know what will happen. We are certain that something will happen, but we don't know whether it will, what manner it will turn around. I can quote an example for this ambiguity. We are into some products, okay? Our competitor also wants to introduce a new product. We don't know, you know, it is an ambiguity situation whether that product will capture the market. And if that product captures the market, what will be the our product's situation in that? So it is a full of ambiguity. So what we have understood, you know, though all this volatility, uncertainty, complexity, ambiguity existed even before the COVID-19, it has become evident and people felt it in a very thorough manner during this COVID-19 that the VUCA situation is unavoidable and it is embedded in the today's business environment. Fine, now we understood and we have accepted that VUCA is unavoidable, inevitable, and it is, and we have to live with VUCA. So given this situation, we have to manage the VUCA related risk. How should we tackle this VUCA related risk? Because unless and until we manage this risk, we are going to get drowned. We will not survive in this environment. So how we have to manage this VUCA related risk? So being in supply chain, it is imperative to build resilient supply chains to build this VUCA related risk, to manage this VUCA related risk. What resilient supply chain? You know, to put it very in a simple word, resilience means the tolerance, to how far we can tolerate. So, and then we can come back to the normal situation. That is the resilient power. The same applies for the supply chain also. How far, if at all some risk or something is predicted in the future, some risk, how far the organizations are matured enough to handle those risks and to sustain. So this is called resilient. So how to build the resilient supply chain, that we will see it in the forthcoming slides. And one more thing is agile supply chain. What agility means? Agility means how quick, how flexible, how nimble we are respond to the situations. The same goes with agile supply chains also. How fast the organization can act to the disruptions or can act to the changes, the external factors, and how well they can protect themselves from the external factors and sustain. So this is what agile supply chain is actually. In fact, having this resilient and agile supply chains in our organization not only will help us to tide over the crisis, but also help us, you know, to change the crisis, to turn this adversity to our advantage. Okay, till now we understood, you know, what are the lessons we learned from this COVID-19 and how to manage risk, and what are resilient and supply chains. Okay, now many of us will ask, okay, whether resilient and supply chains are only to handle the risk or any other benefits apart from that. As I already told, it is not only to handle the risk, it has to be embedded in the system for an organization to be so matured. Resilient and agile supply chains will help us to act faster to the environmental changes and help us to recover to our original or even better than the original thing in a very shortest period of time. I would like to quote some example for this resilient and agile supply chains. During COVID-19, we were hearing, you know, many of the organizations, they were having some supply chain disruptions, mostly automobile industries, I can see. So those industries, you know, though they were aware of their primary vendors, they didn't have an eye on the sub vendors. So during the eruption of the COVID-19, when they look back and turn to who are their sub vendors, they found that the sub vendors are from a certain region. So it is a shock to them. They were not able to source the material from that particular region, since that is the hub of the COVID-19. Because of that, the automobile industries had to undergo incur a huge loss. So some of the industries, they were able to recover quickly. That is because of their resilient and agile supply chains. You know, they were able to track down their sub vendors, and then they took the necessary precautions whatever the changes that need to be done in their supply chains, they were able to respond quickly to the changes, so they could ensure their supply chain in the shortest period of time. This enhanced supply chain performance and competitiveness. And last but not the least, having a resilient and agile supply chains will not only help us to mitigate the risk, but also help us to prosper. I would like to quote some examples. During COVID-19, many of the industries, they faced some supply chain disruptions and their products were not selling. But some of the industries, they use these times, you know, the difficult times also to their advantage. They ventured into the manufacturing of the sanitizers, the N95 mask and medical oxygen. Many of the industrial gas markets, you know, that time during COVID-19, the medical oxygen was in huge demand. So many of the players, they took it to their favor, and they started putting so many plants for medical oxygen, which ultimately turned to their favor. So by having a resilient and agile supply chains, will not help us, not only help us to tide over the crisis, but also to prosper, and we can turn the adversity to our advantage. Now, having seen the benefits of resilient and agile supply chains, As an organization, how to build a resilient and agile supply chains? What are all the key elements that are required for an organization to have the resilient and agile supply chains? The first one is culture. Okay, people, the organization may have the enough people, money, all this external forces, everything. But unless and until there is a culture of change embedded in the organization and in the employees and in the people, it is very difficult for any organization to build a resilient and agile supply chains. Unless and until people have the culture to accept the new good things and to incorporate in their day-to-day routine, it is very difficult. See, for example, why I am insisting on the culture. The company may spend thousands of money in developing the putting new systems and processes, everything. But unless and until people have the mindset to adapt to the new process and systems, and they have to realize that this systems are for good, and this is what the future is, and the people have to rely that our culture, it is in line with the strategy. Some of the very matured organizations, they will have the mindset, okay, this is how I am working since 50 years or 30 years, things are doing fine, then why should I change? If those resistance keep lying in the people or in the organization's culture, it is very difficult. So the first base requirement is the culture of the organization to be aligned with the strategy, and people should have a culture to adapt to the new changes, and their culture has to be aligned with the strategy. Further, if there are multi levels of hierarchy level in this organization, it is very difficult for organization to undergo a change, because people at multi levels has to be, they have to be convinced and the message has to be passed on. Instead, if the organization has got a very flattened organizational hierarchy, it is very difficult for the leaders to pass on their message to the employees and to make them realize the importance of the change, which will be aligned with the strategy. So the culture and the organizational structure plays a very vital role in developing this resilient and agile supply chains. After culture, then comes the people. As already stated, your organization without the right people is nothing but a mortar and bricks. So people play a vital role in developing the culture also, and in having in adapting the process that align with the strategy. So normally, procurement as far as supply chains are concerned, develop the people. You know, normally the thing till now, the process is like, okay, as and when the requirement comes, okay, we will get the offers, make the bid tab, and then they place the order to the L1 vendors. We don't till now the process is not so matured to think beyond that. Okay, whether the vendor will be able to supply that. Okay, or all the orders are going to a single vendor or to a particular region. Tomorrow, if some force majeure happens, are we in a position to handle all those stuff? So these things are not getting analyzed in detail at the current scenario. So for developing the people in supply chain roles, it is imperative to have the people bifurcated into tactical sourcing and strategic sourcing professionals. The tactical sourcing people, okay, they can act with a myopic view of completing this day-to-day activities like getting the RFQs, collecting the offers, preparing the bid tab, and placing the order to the competitive vendors, whereas supply chain or whereas the strategic sourcing team, they have to work with a long-term view, like any new product can be developed in the market, how are the competitors, they are able to quote at a low prices, what best can be done to our organization so that we can get the competitive vendors from the vendors, and how can we leverage the vendors capabilities, whether any supply agreement can be put in place keeping the long-term view, like how many orders we are expecting in this coming financial years, are we having this enough vendor base, So if at all we don't have the enough vendor base, how to develop this? What are all the regions we are expecting the project? How to develop the vendor base? Which region the vendors have to be developed? And what categories of the vendors have to be developed? So, you know, the strategic sourcing people have to think beyond the obvious. They have to have a long-term view. They have to see the future, and they have and the strategic sourcing people have to make the organization ready to face the challenges. So normally for all the budding organizations, it is imperative to have both tactical, the procurement team, as well as the strategic sourcing team. Further, it is very important, like the organization have to understand, like, anyone and everyone can't come and do the procurement. The procurement people should have the proper learning capabilities. They have to have the proper training, and then only they will be in a position to add value to the organization. And gone are those days, you know, like the organization behaved, they are the boss to the vendors. Now the situation is not like that. Given the globalization, the vendors also have a very good reach, and it is imperative to treat vendors properly. To have a you know, win-win situation during the tough times also, it is always suggested to have a collaborative approach to the vendors. So these are some of the points that by developing the people, you know, by having these SEM skills, the organization can build resilient and agile supply chains. Now process. The process I mean here is the various KRAs, the objectives, and whatever this e-sourcing platforms that we are using, and whatever this approval levels that we are going through to have some orders in place. So these constitutes mainly all those processes. As per Peter Drucker, what gets measured gets managed. That is true in our supply chains also. Now, majority of the organizations, they focus only on cost savings. Even if you see the KRAs of the procurement team, it will be mainly the savings. I don't deny that savings should be the main KRA for procurement, but it should not be the one and only objective of any organization. So now what happened because of overemphasizing, you know, obsession with the savings, the organizations also lose a track on the suppliers, their past history of the suppliers, all those stuff. I would quote an example. In this during COVID, this automobile industries, they have the managed, you know, they have placed the orders on some tier one vendors. Their sub vendors, you know, they have placed orders on some sub vendors. And those vendors, they are from the particular region only. So once a COVID struck, the main vendor, okay, the organization know who their vendors are. If they contact, they contact, okay, where is the material? Their vendors, they are unable to provide the materials because their sub vendors lies in the region where COVID has hit. Now it is imperative for the organizations to not only know about their vendor, but they should know about who are the sub vendors are, where they mainly lie, whether they are from the same region. So all these things will help if there are some political tension, or if there are some political tension or due to logistics problem also we can anticipate. So it is always better the procurement professionals should not only take care of the cost savings, but also they should be keen to have a proper track record on the supplier performance and what their strategies are. So this is very much important when any VUCA related risk struck the organization. Now the key takeaways are, mitigate the risk or to spread the risk, it is always better to have the globalization. It means like we should not place the order on a single vendor or from a single region. We should have the supply network across geographies. But COVID-19 has taught us always globalization also will not help. because due to COVID-19, many of the countries have banned. So due to the logistics problem, our organizations were not able to get the materials from the other countries. Now, after this COVID, it is a blessing in disguise. Now, organizations are trying for the nearshoring sourcing. It means like sourcing the materials from our own country. It in fact will develop our economy, and it will help us so that in future, if any COVID-19 kind of situation erupts again, the organizations will not depend on the global supply chain. Instead, they can rely on the local supply chain and source the material. And another main important thing is, it is very imperative to treat the vendors with respect, and we have to keep on monitoring their performance so that we will have a proper tab on them. If at all, we are placing order on some vendor. At the time of placing the order, the vendor's financial status was great. And after that, we lose a track on the vendor. That is not the case. We should have a proper track on whether the vendor is falling at any risk, whether the vendor's country is at risk, or whether the financial status is at risk. Nowadays, the company started following this Dun & Bradstreet report, which gives the organization's financial report. If at all any country level risk is there, how the country is prospering, or economy level risk is there, or any political tension, all those stuff, it is imperative to keep on monitoring on regular basis, so that at the last minute of time, we need not worry, this vendor has gone wrong. And further, the moment I say it is supplier performance, we should have a robust contracts with the supplier also. It is always suggested, like whenever we are drafting contract, we should always a contract clause in place. Like if at all the organization found any lethargic or a deviation in the vendor's performance, the organization shall have the liberty to cancel the contract and to go on with the other vendors, and they can recover the amount incurred from the existing vendor. So this will help the organization to protect the interest. And last but not the least, it is imperative to have a very good relationship with the vendors, and for a better alignment with the vendor and to ensure the continuous supply, it is recommended to follow this collaborative planning, forecasting and replenishment method, which help us for the long-term planning and to manage the risk. Now, having said that, it is imperative to manage all the sub vendors and to know what our vendors are doing, what are all the risks involved with the vendors. It is imperative to have a technology, the robust system in the place. Now, for example, as I already mentioned about this Dun & Bradstreet, which gives a ready-made information about the vendors with whom we are dealing. And many other market reports also, online reports also, gives the various risks involved in our vendors. And further, having a robust system like getting the details from our sub-vendors, from our vendors, who their sub-vendors are, and maintaining it in our technology, in our system, will help us to know the material readiness and what risk we are carrying with the sub-vendors, and where our materials are from, whether from which region we are expecting our materials, so that we will be in a position to see, what are all the risks like we are having. Say, for example, now that China has implemented the energy consumption reduction. So I'm sure that many of our sub vendors, they are from China. By having the details of those vendors, so what is the percentage of our material that we are sourcing from China, and where our sub vendors are from, the organizations will be in a position to track those vendors, and they can have what will be the impact in the delivery, what will be the impact in the prices, whether we will be in a position to get the materials on time. So all those stuff needs to be done by having a robust technology thing. Now, one more thing, this real-time analytics and decision support tools, that is a main part in that. By having a proper, for any organization, it is imperative to have the analytics tool, so that they will be in a position to decide for a particular project from where we have sourced, how better can be done. So if the project is some XYZ country, so how it is beneficial to source from ABC country or EFG country, something like that, and based on the logistics. So by having this robust system in place, we will be in a position to analyze the data and we will be in a position to take decisions. Further, by this blockchain kind of things, we can ask our vendors also to upload their purchase order copies for better tracking. So how the blockchain works, by integration of our system, there is our own company system in this blockchain, the vendor can upload their contracts and our system can pick up only the particular data that is required by us, the sub-vendor name, the region, all those stuff. So by having all those things get uploaded, we will have a very seamless supply chain wherein we will be in a position to get the data what we require to handle this VUCA related risk. So that way, technology plays a vital role in building resilient and agile supply chains. Now we have come to it. By this COVID-19 and all those situations that we are seeing right now, it is decided that this VUCA is a embedded or interesting part in our business system. And it is also like whatever we do, there are some chances that something will go wrong or we will have to face some risk. That is there, and we can't come out of that. The matter is how we are facing the risk and how fast we are acting on it and how good we are acting to a risk. That matters how we can survive. So as Charles Darwin told, it is not the strongest of the species that survive, nor the most intelligent, but the one most responsive to change. That means as being in SCM, we will have to have this resilient and agile supply chains to manage the risk that are awaiting in the future. Okay, it is not only that we will have to act and we have to face the risk. It is also very important that we have to capture the lessons that we have learned while facing all this risk so that we can have a repository for the future people to refer those and they can take the hints from how we have handled and how best the situation can be handled in future.